Welcome to iTech Academy online classes. I am Azam sir. Today we are going to talk about unit number 2 of grade 11 syllabus. That is System Development Lifecycle, or the short form SDLC. I am going to complete this unit by discussing some questions. Let's see. Question number 1. What is a system? Let's see the definition for system. A system is a collection of interrelated components which performs a specific task. There are a lot of examples for systems in our world. Examples for systems are computer system, library system, respiratory system, and etc. We will take an example and discuss the definition of the system. Take computer as a system. We can identify computer system as a collection of interrelated components. Computer system has hardware, software, firmware, liveware. These are the components of a computer system, and they are interrelated to perform a specific task. That specific task is processing data into meaningful information. So we can say a system as a collection of interrelated components which performs a specific task. Question number 2. What are the basic elements of a system? Answer: input, process, output. If we take any natural or artificial systems, they are having 3 basic elements: input, process, and output. Question number 3. Identify the objective, comma, input, comma, process, and output of following systems. There are 3 systems given in the screen: weather forecasting system, fingerprint system, respiratory system. We have to identify their objectives, input, process, and output. First, take weather forecast system. The objective of a weather forecasting system is to predict the weather condition. That means a weather forecasting system is used to predict our weather condition. To predict this weather condition, that system needs some inputs. They are pressure, temperature, wind direction, humidity, and other environmental data. When these inputs are given to weather forecasting system, it processes it to meaningful information. So what's the process? The process is compare the inputs and decide the weather condition. Finally, weather forecasting system produce tomorrow's weather condition as the output. System number 2, fingerprint system. The objective is to record the attendance in schools and other government as well as private departments. They are using fingerprint machines to record the attendance of employees. So the objective of a fingerprint system is to record the attendance. Then what's the input? Input should be the finger mark or fingerprint of a particular person. Then by getting this input, finger mark of a person, fingerprint system will recognize the finger mark of the person. That's the process. And output of the fingerprint system are date and time of arrival or departure. System number 3, respiratory system. Objective is to supply oxygen to body cells. You know, the input to respiratory system is oxygen, that means O2. Then respiratory system will mix the oxygen with blood and passing it to the body cells. That should be the process of respiratory system. Finally, it's going to produce the output, that is carbon dioxide or CO2. Question number 4. What is an information system? Let's see the definition of information system. A system which converts data into meaningful information is called an information system. So we can say information system as a type of system which converts the data into meaningful information. Already I told that a system has three elements. They are the input, process, output. In an information system, that input is data, and the process will be the same, and output is information. Question number 5. What are the types of information systems? Give examples for each. Basically, information systems are divided into two. They are manual information systems and computer-based or automated information systems. First, we have to discuss about manual information systems. What are manual information systems? In manual information systems, all the processes are done by human manually. That's why we call it manual information system. For an example, a manual student information system in a school, a class record book, or a student attendance register. If we take these examples, all the process related to these systems are done by human manually. Then the second type of information system is computer-based or automated information system. Computer-based information systems are widely used in government and private institutions now. Because in computer-based information systems, data is converted to information by a computer software system. That means not like manual information system. In computer-based information system, data is converted to information by a computer software system. Examples for computer-based information systems are computer-based library systems, fingerprint machine, mobile phone contact list. If we take any of these systems are controlled by a software application inside it. For an example, take mobile phone contact list. When we serve new contacts to mobile phone, that is saved inside the memory of the mobile phone. And when we request the same contact later, there is a software application to search that contact and give us. But manual system, everything done by human manually. So we prefer computer-based information system because of several reasons. Next question, we will discuss the differences between manual and computer-based information systems. Question number 6. List down the main differences between manual information system and computer-based information systems. Let's see the differences. First, manual information system. Data processing is slower and less efficient. The reason for this is, in manual information system, data processing is done by human. Therefore, it will take more time and less in efficient. But other side, computer-based information systems, they are faster and more efficient. Because in computer-based information systems, data is processed by a computer software. Second difference. In manual information system, there is more chance for making errors or mistakes. The reason, manual information system is handled by human manually. We know human has the nature of making mistakes. Therefore, we say manual information systems are less in accuracy. But computer-based information systems are much in accuracy or more in accuracy. The reason, in computer-based information systems, data is processed by a computer software and there is less chance for errors. Fourth difference, manual information systems are requiring a large physical space to store data. Think about a school manual student information system. They have to keep the records of students in file cupboards. For a large school like a national school, it will take 10 or 15 large size cupboards to store this data manually. But computer-based information systems are efficient in terms of space. The reason, large amount of data can be stored in a small physical space. Even in a 16 GB or 32 GB pen drive, we can store the records of many thousands of students in a school. Then the fourth one. Manual information systems are less in security. The main reason, in manual information system, data is open to lot of security threats, such as data theft. Anyone can take the data in manual information system without any permission. That's a big disadvantage in manual information systems, but computer-based systems, we can improve the security by using passwords and other techniques like encryption or backups. Even computer-based systems, we can take backups to avoid any data losses. Examples for manual information systems are teacher attendance book in a school. You can see in schools, teachers sign or teachers mark their attendance in a book. That's an example for manual information system. But the same school can have a fingerprint machine to record the attendance. That can be taken as an example for computer-based information system. Question number 7. What are the advantages of using a computer-based library information system? First advantage, librarian can use a barcode reader to read the ISBN number of books and record the details of that particular book. And also, he or she can use barcode reader to read the barcode of library member cards. Second one, they can search for a particular book efficiently. For an example, can search for a book by giving the name or author or publisher of that book. In manual library system, if you want to search a book, we have to search the entire library to find it. But in computer-based library system, we can search it automatically. Third one, ability to detect whether a particular book is available in the library or not. If it is available, they can also find out the location of that book. Fourth advantage, possibility to list the members, those who have failed to return books on due dates. Fifth one, importantly, librarian can automatically calculate fines for the late returns. In manual library system, they have to find the fine manually by calculating number of days delayed to return the book multiplied by fine per day. But in computer-based library system, system knows the date of borrowing and date of returning. Accordingly, it can calculate the fine for late returns. Last one, ability to provide e-books to library members. When we have a computer-based library system, It can provide e-books like magazines, novels, and other PDF type books to members very easily. So these are the advantages of using a computer-based library information system. Question number 8. What is System Development Lifecycle, SDLC? Let's see the definition. SDLC, or System Development Lifecycle, is a set of steps followed in the development of a new information system. That means when we develop a new information system, we have to develop that system in a step-by-step system. Those steps followed in the development of a new information system is called SDLC. Question number 9. Write down the steps / phases of SDLC. See the screen. There are 6 steps of SDLC. Step number 1, identification of requirements. Step number 2, designing the solution. Step number 3, coding the solution. Fourth, testing and debugging. Fifth one, deployment or implementation of the system. And the last step of SDLC is to maintain the system. Again, there are 6 steps or phases of SDLC: identification of requirements, designing the solution, coding the solution, testing and debugging, deployment, and the last one, maintenance of the system. Question number 10. What is a bug? In IT, bug means an error in a computer program. When we write a computer program, there may be different types of errors. There may be logical errors, runtime errors, syntax errors, and etc. These errors in a program are called bug. And correcting such errors in a program, also known as debug. Debug means correcting different types of errors in a computer program. Question number 11. Identify the main task or activities carried out in each phase of SDLC when developing an information system. We know there are 6 steps in SDLC. First one, identification of requirements. Second, designing the solution. Third one, coding the solution. Fourth one, testing and debugging. Fifth, deployment of the system. Sixth one, maintenance of the system. In each step, we have to carry out some task or activities. Let's see those activities now. Step number 1, identification of requirements. Activities involved in this step are: first one, investigating the existing manual system. Second, identification of objectives, benefits of new system. Third one, collecting information to fulfill the needs of the user. These are the 3 main tasks or activities carried out during the identification of requirements. When we develop a new computer-based information system, first of all, we have to identify the requirements for that new system. Say, we have a manual library system and going to computerize it. So before developing computerized system, we have to investigate the existing manual system. We have to investigate for its task, the method of delivering the service and everything. After that, we have to identify the objective and benefits of developing a new computer-based system. Then we have to collect the information from the user of that particular system. If it is library, we have to collect the information from librarian other relevant people of that system. These three activities are involved in step number one, identification of requirements. After that, we have to design the solution. That means we have to design the computer-based library system. To design the solution, first we have to identify software and software architecture. That's the first activity done under the designing part of the system. After that, we have to design the user interfaces and databases. User interfaces mean the screens we use to interact with our computerized library system. And also, we need a database to store the details related to our library system. For an example, we have to keep the details of members, we have to keep the details of books. Therefore, we need a database in our computerized information system. Third one, we have to identify the main hardware components of the new computer-based information system. For an example, if we develop a computer-based library system, we may need barcode reader. We may need a printer. Those are the main hardware components needed to develop the new computer-based system. So these hardware components also identified during designing of the solution. After that, we have to plan the test. Testing mean identifying the errors or bugs in a computer system. So, before developing the computer-based system, we have to plan the methods of testing those errors in a computer-based system. So, these are the four main activities of designing the solution. After that, we have to move third step, that is coding of the solution. Coding of the solution mean we convert our design into a computer understandable program. Computers can understand only computer languages. Therefore, we have to convert our design into a coding. That's why we call step number three as coding of the solution. Coding of the solution is an important part in system development. So, the main activity involved in this phase is coding the proposed system using a computer language like we learn Pascal. Next step, testing and debugging. The purpose of testing and debugging is to find out any errors in a program and fix them. There are two main tasks involved with testing and debugging. First one, identify the errors in coding and correct them accordingly. Second one, conducting unit integration, system, and user acceptance testing. These are the four types of testing carried out during step number four. We discuss these types of testing later on. Fifth step of SDLC is deployment of the system. Deployment means installing or implementing the newly developed information system in a particular organization. Say we have developed a new computerized library system, then we have to install that computerized library system in the library and start to work. That is called deployment. Last step of SDLC is maintenance of the system. Maintenance step involves four main activities. First one, developing system to suit new user requirements. Second one, fixing the issues that surfaced with the use of any newly developed system which were not identified during system development. And adapting new technology into the new system to improve the efficiency. For an example, when there is a new technology introduced in software industry, we have to adapt that technology. If we want to adapt that technology, definitely we have to maintain our system. So those are the main activities involved with maintenance part of the system development life cycle. Question number 12. Write down the different data or information collecting techniques, that mean methods, that a developer can use to fulfill the needs of the user. Before developing any computer-based information system, we have to gather the requirements for that particular system. To identify these requirements or the needs of the user, we have to collect them. So there are several techniques to collect those requirements or data related to the development of new information system. Let's see those methods. First one, observation. Observation means observing the existing manual system to gather the required information. For an example, when we develop a computer-based library system, we have to observe the existing manual library system and accordingly gather the required data. Second one, interviews. Interviews mean discussing with users of the system and identify the requirements or needs for the new system. For an example, in a library, we can discuss the requirements with librarian other people involved with that system. Third technique, questionnaires. Questionnaire mean set of questions prepared. Questionnaire mean set of questions prepared to collect the user requirement. The person who collect these requirements are called system analyst. So he or she can prepare a set of questions and hand it over to relevant users of the system and accordingly can gather the required data. Fourth one, document sample collection. That means we can examine reports and files maintained in a particular organization. In library, we can check the present manual card system, catalogs, inventory, and everything to determine or identify the need of new information system. Last one, prototyping. Prototyping means a model of the proposed system to be implemented is developed. That means we develop a dummy system before developing the exact one. After developing that prototype, that means dummy system, we will demonstrate it to staff and users of that system and get the feedback. Based on the feedbacks and comments, we have to develop the actual system. This is called prototyping. So these are the five different methods to collect the required data when we develop a new information system. Question number 13. What are the properties of well-written program code? That means when we write a computer program, we have to keep some good properties in that program. When we keep those good properties in a program, we can call it a well-written program code. So, what are the properties of well-written program code? We'll see. First one, it should be simple. The program code written by us should be very simple. Second one, it should be easy to read and understand. Third one, it should reduce maintenance cost. Again, a well-written program code should be simple, easy to read and understand, reduces maintenance cost. Question number 14. Write down the different methods to test a system in order. Explain them briefly. After developing any new information system, we have to test it for errors. Already I told that a system can have different types of errors in it. So we have to identify those errors before implementing that system. There is an order to test a newly developed computerized system. The order is first unit testing, second one integration testing, third one system testing, fourth one user acceptance testing. We will discuss these testing methods in detail. First one, unit testing. Unit testing, the objective is to test the each unit in the system for given input. That means a particular computerized information system may have different units. For an example, if we take library information system, the units may be maintaining the details of books, lending the book, returning the book, generating reports. So we can take those as four units of our library information system. So after developing that library information system, we have to test this individual unit for given inputs. That means we have to provide the inputs to these individual units and check whether that unit produces correct output or not. Normally, unit testing is carried out by computer programmers. Next one, integration testing. The objective of integration testing is to combine or integrate the units already tested into a group of units and test them for errors. By this, we try to form the complete system and tested for errors. For an example, I told library information system has four units: maintaining the details of books, lending the books, returning the books, and generating the reports. Under the integration testing, we may integrate units. For an example, we could integrate maintaining the details of books and lending the books and check whether those components are integrated properly and working without any errors. That is called integration testing. Likewise, the complete system will be tested for errors. And also carried out by the integration testing is also carried out by integration testers or test team. In a software development company, there will be test teams for this purpose. Next testing step is system testing. We'll see the objective first. The complete system is tested for its functionality by checking the outputs for the given inputs. That means here we have to feed some sample inputs to the newly developed computer system and check whether that system produces correct output or not. By that, we try to verify whether that system functions correctly or not. System testing also carried out by test teams. Then the last stage of testing is user acceptance testing. User acceptance testing is carried out by test team with users of that particular system. For an example, library information system has to be tested by the test team with users of the library. Maybe librarian and other library staffs. The objective is to see whether the system is acceptable to the users. Because that particular system is developed for the use of users. So users only need to test whether that system is acceptable. Therefore, we call this testing as user acceptance testing. Here, users use the system and either approve it or request for more improvements. Therefore, the user acceptance testing can be taken as a very critical part in testing stage. The reason, if user accept that system, next stage it can be implemented. But when request for some changes, when user request for some changes, software developers or system developers have to go through the SDLC steps again and complete the system. Question number 15. What is system deployment? List down different deployment approaches to deploy a newly developed information system with proper examples. After completing the testing phase of SDLC, we can start to deploy the system. Already I told that deployment means installing newly developed computerized system in an organization and start to operate it. So there are four different approaches to implement or deploy the system you developed. We'll see them one by one. First one, direct deployment. Second, parallel deployment. Third one, pilot deployment. Fourth one, phased or staged deployment. Deployment has a similar word called implementation. Sometime in the exam paper, you may get the word implementation. So implementation means the deployment of the system. Direct deployment. This is the simplest method of deployment. In this deployment, the very important thing is given in red color. See the screen. In this deployment, the existing manual system is totally terminated and The new system is installed. That means in direct deployment system, we have to stop the existing manual system and start to implement the newly developed computerized system. This is demonstrated by the given diagram. See the diagram. So far, we had the old system. Now, we are going to terminate that old system and start the new one. This is called direct deployment. For an example, in library, we can terminate the existing manual library system and install the new one. Direct deployment method has some advantages as well as disadvantages. These advantages and disadvantages are very important for the exam. The advantages of direct deployment are the implementation is faster than other deployment method. The reason we have to terminate the existing manual system and start the new one. Therefore, it is fast. Second, this is the least expensive deployment method. Reason, we have to terminate the manual system and just start the new system. So it will be very cheap. But the disadvantage is this deployment or implementation method is not safe. The reason, when we implement a new system, the problems may arrive unpredictably. Therefore, the manual system also terminated. Now, we don't have any option to continue our system functionality because newly developed computerized system also has some problems. Manual system also totally terminated. So we don't have any option to continue our work. Therefore, direct implementation is not safe. Second deployment method is parallel deployment. Here, the existing manual system and newly developed computerized system are used parallel for a certain period. When the new system proves successful, the old system can be terminated and the new system continues. For an example, we can run both manual library system and newly developed computerized library system together for a period of time. When we feel that new system works properly, then we can stop the present manual system and continues only the new system. This is demonstrated by the given diagram. From the beginning, we are having old system. During that, we implement the new system with old system parallelly for a period of time, and after that, continues only the new system. There are a lot of advantages of parallel deployment. The main thing, parallel adoption or parallel deployment is the most foolproof method. Second, this is safe because both systems are used parallel. When there is a problem in newly developed computerized system, we can work with the old system. Therefore, most of the
software developers prefer parallel deployment because of safe. But it has two disadvantages. The first one, duplication of effort. For an example, we have to enter the data to both manual and computerized system. So the work is going to be duplicated. Second one, it can also be the most time consuming and expensive deployment method. Reason, we have to run two systems parallelly. Therefore, we have to spend more time as well as money for the deployment. Third deployment method is pilot deployment. Pilot deployment is about installing the newly developed system in a selected area of a country or department of an organization for testing purpose and evaluation. Once the test group has approved the system, it can be rolled out across the country or organization. That means in pilot deployment, we install the new system in a selected area only. Don't install it to the entire country or the entire department. As a testing, we install it in a selected area and get the feedback of test group. Based on that feedback, we can roll out across the country or organization. See the diagram. We have all system and start the new system in a selected region or area. Based on the feedback and approval of the test group, we can implement that system to the entire country or department. For an example, a computerized system for revenue collection from vehicles can first be implemented in one province of the country. Say, we implement it in Western province first. If it is successful, then it can be deployed in all the other provinces in the country. This is called pilot deployment. Last deployment method is phased or staged deployment. It involves incremental deployment of a new system. The new system is deployed in stages. Success with each stage leads to the next and in completing the new system. The old system is completely replaced by the new. That means we have the existing manual system and take one stage of that system and computerize it. Then take the next stage or next part. Like that, the entire manual system is converted to computerized form. This is called phased or staged deployment. Question number 16. Name the system development life cycle models in use. The answer: waterfall model, iterative incremental model, prototyping model, spiral model. These are the four different system development lifecycle models used in software industry. Let's see these models one by one. First model is waterfall model. What is waterfall model? The waterfall model is a sequential process model used in system development. As the name implies, outcome of each stage flows into the next stage. Accordingly, complete one stage before going to the next phase. Simply, in waterfall model of system development, we develop the system in stages. That means we start with first step, then complete it and move to the next phase. Like that, system development happens in a sequential process. See the diagram on screen. Waterfall model has six steps or stages. Step number one is called identification of requirement. So when we develop a new system based on waterfall model, we have to identify the requirements for new system. After that step only, we can start the planning part of the solution. Next, we move to the implementation, then testing and debugging, then deployment. Like that, system development goes in a linear system. Simply, it flows like a waterfall. That's why we call this model as a waterfall model. We cannot start a particular step before completing another previous step. For an example, we can't start the testing and debugging of solution before completing the implementation of the solution. First, we have to complete the implementation part and move to testing and debugging. Therefore, waterfall model should be applied for well understood systems only, because we don't have any option to go back to a previous step in waterfall model. Therefore, when we know the all requirements and needs of the system only, we have to select the waterfall model. And the result of the system developed is found at the final stage only. That means to see the outcome of this software development, we have to wait up to the last stage or final stage of waterfall model. Therefore, users see the system at the end of the life cycle, and this can be taken as a main limitation of the waterfall model. Second development model is iterative incremental model. Here, we develop one small component of a system at a time in an iterative fashion. That means, first we develop the small part of the system. Like that, we iterate the system development. That means we repeat the system development. In each iteration, we develop more components of the system. Therefore, the system gets developed more and more incrementally until the last stage. See the diagram on the screen. We start with initial planning. I told that iterative incremental model developed system component by component. Say we are going to develop the first component of the system. So we have to identify the requirements for that component. After that, we have to do the actual planning and then start the analysis and design. Then we have to do the implementation and testing. Then evaluation. Here we have to evaluate whether first component is correctly developed or not. Then move to the second iteration and start to develop the second component by identifying the requirement for that component. Then again, planning, analysis and design, implementation, testing, evolution. Likewise, we have to develop the components in an iterative fashion until the entire system is developed. At last, we have to deploy the complete system. This method has a very big advantage. That is, system developers have the advantage of using the knowledge gained in the earlier iteration. That means, within each iteration, they can get a knowledge about their software development. Based on that knowledge, they can develop the system very well. This model of system development is suitable for complex and high risky system developments. Then the third model is spiral model. The spiral model is the combination of iterative incremental development model and the sequential linear model, that means waterfall model. Simply, spiral model has the properties of both iterative incremental model and waterfall model. You can see the diagram. Here also, like iterative incremental model, that particular information system is developed in iterations. That means we start with a prototype first and adding the functionalities to that prototype. This will happen repeatedly to develop the final system. This model is not that much important for all of us. But we have to understand the spiral model is suitable for systems where project risk is medium to high and also requirements are complex. So, today I have completed the unit number 2 of grade 11 ICT syllabus. I hope that all of you have understood the concept I explained so far. Thank you for listening. Thank you.